Hey, it's Birdman for Birdman Media Patriot Edition here, still at the 2017 SHOT Show, hanging out in the press room. Another busy day here at SHOT, crowded. Always love the navigation of people and then dogs and then also the carts and the occasional speeding Segway. Not my most fun moment at SHOT, but so with me today and starting off, I've got Kat Ainsworth. How are you?
Pretty good. How are you doing?
Yeah, I'm doing well. So you've been writing for quite some time, huh?
About 5 years now.
5 years? Cool. Yeah. And who are you currently?
I'm a freelance outdoor writer.
Okay.
But I do have a couple specific publications I write for on the most frequent basis. I have a column in Gun World magazine. It's called Artemis Armed. And I do a fair amount of work for the NRA pubs, like Shooting Illustrated, a little bit for American Hunter. I also write for Guns and Ammo Handguns magazine and Gun Dog. So that's like my core group.
I like the Guns and Ammo. I've seen you in there.
Their stuff is cool.
The handgun magazine. Yeah. That one's always been fun for me. So, okay, so talk to me a little bit about what you've seen here at the show. You know, you, like many people, fought some of the weather coming here.
Oh, yeah.
Wonderful airplane movements. This is why I drive a car as much as possible.
So we can all be jealous of you.
So tell me what you've seen here at the show so far. Cool stuff.
I have like a trifecta of favorites. I have an ammo, a gun, and a trigger.
Nice.
And the ammo that I like is being made by Polycase. And I talked to Paul Lemke over there yesterday. They don't have the ammo in their booth yet, but they are going to be shipping it this spring. It's 10 mil. Which I'm thrilled about because they make a wonderful frangible round, close up on steel. It's accurate, cycled nicely. It's good stuff. And getting a 10 mil round out there, do some hog hunting.
Yeah.
Looking forward to trying it.
Yeah, 10 millimeters, the real hot new ticket, isn't it?
It is. Handgun hunting is finally catching on. People are finally getting it.
And you know, it's 9 mil sort of like my favorite still, probably because I just haven't invested the money in the 10 mil gun.
And 9 mils. The best seller right now. You know, it was 380, but 9 mils rolled back as soon as the FBI says, hey, we're going back to 9 mil.
Boom. Yeah.
Yep. Sales are there.
Okay. So, and then you said a trifecta, so we had ammo.
I do. I've got a gun to go with the ammo, the Colt Delta Elite, also, of course, a 10 mil. And it's got a rail on the bottom, so if you want to hunt with a light, you can. It's got some pretty nice sights on it, which, of course, you can swap out if you have a specific sight you want to put on it. If you're not just target shooting, but you actually want to hunt with it, which one of their LE guys who works in sales, Aaron Sedbury, he's been doing some hunting with it. And I took a look at that today. It's comfortable. It's smooth. It's got an extended beaver tail on the back, so you can keep a more solid grip. It's a nice gun. It's got something like a $1,200 price point on it. So, you know, it's an investment, but a good, accurate hunting gun is always worth the investment. And you get your return in meat, so.
Very good. Yeah. Your return in meat.
Exactly.
Now, so tell me, with 10 millimeter, what do you think as far as, like, woods defense? Is that going to be pretty substantial for that kind of a situation?
I like it. I like the Glock 29. It's a nice 10 mil. There are other 10 mils I like, but the Glock 29, you know, it's a compact. So you actually can conceal it. I can conceal it. I have trouble concealing full size, but compacts I can. I always say that you should carry, or should I say buy, what you will carry, not just leaving your gun safe, and what you're actually comfortable shooting. You know, if you get something that's too big for you and you're like, oh man, it's cool, but I'm leaving it in my gun safe. You know,
Right. Actually
take what you will actually carry and use, and then train to use something bigger because bigger holes drain body fluids faster. So.
Yes, they do, and they also shock a little bit more.
They do.
Yeah.
So big is good.
Very good. That makes a total amount of sense there.
You need a bigger gun. We'll have to work on that.
As big as you can carry and deal with it. Yeah.
We need like an 80 millimeter handgun.
Okay, the third of your trifecta.
The third, I'm actually pretty stoked about this. Timney Triggers has a new trigger out. Went over there and talked to Ed Mazio and got a look at it. It's the Calvin Elite AR trigger. It's light and crisp. It has a 1.5 pound trigger pull, and it's fully adjustable. So if you want to angle it to the right or to the left, you can adjust everything on this trigger. And it's just so light and crisp and comfortable. It's almost unbelievable. I was just ridiculously excited when I saw it.
Yeah.
And it comes in five colors.
Oh.
So if you like to trick out your gun, it comes in black and red and green and gold. So.
Yeah, colors are always fun, aren't they? Yeah.
They are, and it comes with three different shoes. So if you want curved or straight or an L-shaped, you can swap it out, put whatever you want on it.
And specifically, you can actually position that where you want it, like you're saying, so dependent upon how that finger sits.
Yeah.
That's pretty darn cool.
It's fully cant adjustable and everything.
So coming up in the Get on Target show that I do with the Hub, we're actually going to be talking about Glocks and the fanaticism that comes with Glocks and almost like drink the Glock Kool-Aid kind of a moment. I was a Smith & Wesson guy and literally the run of every single one of their handguns, and have slowly sold them off and they've been replaced with almost Glock 19s, but that's a whole other story.
Okay. To each their own.
So what do you think about that as far as anybody that's talking about things? You know, I've got one opinion about why people should get guns, but what do you think people should do they jump to Glock just because, well, that's it? Or
they're more affordable. And the publicity is out there for your average person who doesn't actually know a lot about guns or the industry. They buy what they see.
Mm-hmm.
They flip open the magazines, you know, that I write for. They see a gun in there that looks cool. They see the ammo we put through it in the test, and they will frequently buy that.
Right.
Which is why I work so hard to be honest, you know, and do my own quality control. But frankly, I do like Glocks. I wouldn't say I've totally gone full Kool-Aid, but but my first carry gun was a Glock. I actually still have that one. It was a 27, so it's the 40 S&W.
Nice.
It's accurate. It saved my daughter's life once when she was little. So, you know, I like them. It's my most comfortable gun. I find them comfortable grip. You know, they come in all the calibers.
Yeah.
And they're, I think the big ticket is publicity and affordable.
Yeah, and to be clear, I still have my Smith & Wesson 9C. I still have a VP9. I still have a SIG P226. And, you know, yeah, it's the gambit of things. But it was kind of funny that recently it was like a shift of, oh, crap, you know, here I go. And of course, Bruce is a big Glock fan, and he has many others, too. It was sort of like, ha-ha, see, told you. There's a reliability and consistency factor, I think, that sort of factors in it. Awesome.
Oh, yeah. You know, they can take a beating and they keep going. You know, I've had one for 15 years, and I tell people it's always cycled flawlessly, and they think I'm full of it.
Yeah.
But it's a good gun. So.
It is what it is. Now, I got one more question for you as a female, because you probably get in, and my wife gets this too, is like all of a sudden it's like, oh, well, you know, female shooters, they have differences. And it's like, there might be some differences, but there's a lot of similarity, isn't there?
Oh, yeah. We want what the guys want. And, you know, what I say is that people should just go according to size. I don't care if you're male or female, big hands, small hands, tall, short, your length of pull is different. Your cheekbones might be different. I don't have cheekbones to save my life. I went to a booth today and they're talking about women's high cheekbones. And I'm thinking, is there a mirror? Because did I get cheekbones? That would be so cool. But, you know, everyone's different regardless of gender. So if we just fit according to the size of the person in front of us, I think it would save a lot. Some women like the pink, you know, and the purple, and Kimber makes some really pretty guns that actually are like bright purple. They're awesome, the amethyst. But mostly we want what the guys want.
Very cool. I'd say
99%.
Awesome, cool. Well, hey, I want to thank you very much for your time.
Appreciate
you coming up here today.
Absolutely.
You're going to be running off, jumping on an airplane, and
hopefully
flying home in a tube. Sorry about that. Hey, that'll be it for Kat right now, but we're going to have some other people coming up, so hang on there, and I'll be right back in just a sec. Okay, still hanging out here in the press room at SHOT Show 2017. I've got with me now Evan. How you doing, Evan?
Good. How are you, Rob?
Is it Privy?
Yeah, that's close enough.
Privy. Got it.
Yep.
How you doing, Evan?
Doing good.
And you're with LAG Tactical, which is like a glove.
That's exactly right.
Awesome stuff. So, hey, let's talk about the show, what you showed new here, and how are things going?
The show's been great. We've had a lot of press coverage, and we're really thankful for that. We were lucky enough to have Craig Sawyer come spend a few hours with us in the booth. Jared Ogden's been with us from Triumph Systems, and that's been great. And it's really been an overwhelming show. Yeah. So much foot traffic, so much attention. It's been great.
Yeah, so picking up some dealers, showing some people that haven't seen the product.
Yeah, we've actually picked up a few new distributors. We've met with Gander Mountain, Shields, a lot of big box stores, and it's been great.
Very cool. So let me ask you this now. Have you been able to get out and see any of this show yourself?
Not at all.
Not at all.
None whatsoever.
It's amazing that you get locked into that little, what is it, 10 by 10 or 10 by 20?
10 by 10.
10 by 10 space, and that's where you live your world for 4 days.
Yep.
You get an occasional escape and, like, run up to see me or something like that, or run out and get burgers, right?
Yeah. I did get burgers this morning.
Yeah.
So I brought extra staff this year thinking I'd be able to spend some time, go out and network. But the amount of foot traffic has just been unbelievable. And we're really happy about that.
Very cool. New products, did I mention that? Or we talk about any?
Yeah, so we have a signature series line with Craig Sawyer. He's been endorsing us wholeheartedly, and we're proud to be working with him. We also have a signature holster for Josh Jackson, who's the head of LMS Defense.
Oh, wow.
And he has developed an appendix light-bearing holster that has really been making people happy.
Very cool. Awesome. Anything else you want to mention about things that are happening or what you got coming up?
Well, we do have some exciting stuff coming out this year. We won't be announcing too much of it till NRA.
Okay.
So stay tuned for some really exciting stuff at NRA.
Very cool.
We have some cool swag at our booth, so if you are at SHOT Show, come and see us, and we'll hook you up.
In fact, I think one of the items is this wallet.
That's right.
You got to check this thing out. We'll talk a little bit about this wallet.
Yeah.
And then I have a product of yours that I've had actually for some time and been using for some time that we're going to throw a review up on.
Awesome.
Both can be inside or outside a waistband holster for VP9.
Yep.
Then a really cool holster for the, or mag holster, let's put it that way, for the AR-15.
Yep.
Yeah.
So yeah, our AR mag carrier is totally universal, works for lefties, righties, and anything from GI mags to P mags, Tango Down, all the mags we've come across so far.
Very cool. Awesome. Well, thank you very much, Previn.
Thanks for having me.
Previn. Evan.
It's a nice way to blend both.
Right. Just combo your names. Previn.
Yeah, I'm going to go with that.
Hey, cool. We've got a few other people hanging out here, and just hang on, and we'll get them reached here in a second. Okay, still hanging out here at the press room at SHOT Show 2017. With me now, I've got the group from, well, a couple from Sticky Holsters. Okay. So I've got Vanessa and Mike. Almost called her a different name, but the name badge saved me. I'll give up my
trick
there.
That's what it's there for.
Yeah, exactly. So Sticky Holsters is a company I found through Interius Alliance. You guys are a part of that group, supporting veterans, supporting first responders, and you know, coming together in a way that helps all the other people in the alliance as well.
Absolutely.
Sticky Holsters, Mike, it's your company, right?
It is.
Yeah, so
it is.
Why don't you give me a little background on yourself and then how you sort of evolved to the point where you're making these sticky holsters, and we'll get to why it's sticky.
Sure. Well, background, law enforcement. I was in law enforcement for 25 years, law enforcement firearms instructor. Also then leaving law enforcement, went into, we purchased a mobile shooting range, did a whole lot of training for folks, had a small little gun shop and range, and folks were not happy with the different opportunities they had for concealed carry.
Right.
So we started playing around a little bit, like any, basically created a hybrid, took a little bit from some other different applications, put it together, and Sticky Holsters was born.
Yeah. Cool. So, Stephanie. Yeah, see, I don't know why I wanted her to be a Stephanie.
It's
Vanessa.
Okay. I can be.
Oh, gee, dang. What do you think about this holster, and how did it come into your scope of understanding, or where'd you find out about it?
So what I love about it is that, you know, women love it because, you know, it doesn't have to have any clips or anything like that. And, you know, there's a lot of concealed carry out there. But
right.
Primarily for women, you know, depending on the type of attire that we wear, we don't want something really bulky. So it was very nice when I found out about this. I came into the business. Actually, my mom works with me, and she's actually a seamstress there. And I came in, and she kind of brought me along. And I started off, you know, packing up the holsters. So I got really in-depth and saw how much I liked it. And then actually went into the sewing department. And so I got actually my hands into it and really saw what it was all about. Really got excited on how everything was with it. And then I moved up to a sales rep. So now I'm actually really excited to actually promote it and really get my hands out there and encourage everybody else, especially women, to carry it because it is so slim fit.
Yeah,
what she's trying to say, Rob, is she's running the company now.
You know, and she did it from bottom up. So,
oh, it's wonderful.
Or from entry up. I get the bottom term always.
Organic
weird.
Growth.
Yeah.
How's
it? But or vertical
Vertical, yeah, advancement.
Yeah, advancement. So it's very interesting to me when somebody, and it's one of the things I'll do with my kids, is they're going to work in retail and they're going to work in food service.
Mm-hmm.
Because when you understand the basis of anything,
yeah,
the foundation of how it all works, how it goes together, you know how these are sewn.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so you're not selling something that you're like conceptually get.
Right? Yeah.
Oh,
no.
You know it inside. Mm-hmm.
It's a part
and
of
out.
You. Sure.
Yeah. Cool. And obviously, you know, you started from the beginnings of when it didn't exist. So let's talk about the functionality. What it is? What is it? You know, it's got. We've said no clips and stuff like that, so we can hold up and show
this.
Yeah.
So of course, sticky holsters. It's an inside the waistband and pocket holster. Has no clips or loops on it, so it's great. You don't have to deal with that. Our material on the outside allows it to work under compression in the waistband and friction in the pocket. So every time that you put it in your waistband or pocket, you just put a little bit of compression or friction, and every time you draw the gun out, the holster is going to stay intact.
That's very cool.
Yeah, and since you don't have those clips, the weight of the gun isn't going to draw your pants down. And since there are no clips, you don't need a belt, which is why women do love us, because they can wear it with yoga pants, leggings, athletic shorts, do any type of running or agility work, and it's always going to stay right where you placed it.
Yeah, now, so when Mike gave me one, he said, here's what I want you to do. I want you to, you know, just try it out and then just see how it works.
Mm-hmm.
So the whole, I think, scenario you laid out was, you know, if you got to run to the grocery store one night or something like that. So
sure.
I carry all the time. And, you know, it's part of, you just do it because that's the conditioning you want to make sure that you're never sitting somewhere and going, oh, crap, now is the time I needed it and I don't have it.
Murphy comes to visit at the worst times.
Yeah. So, and I normally do it in a certain holster that I have that's attached by clips and, mm-hmm. other, you know. So it happened, you know, one night, and my wife's pregnant. So she goes, hey, you know, I want you to go get some milk or something. The kids need milk. And here I am, you know, I've already sort of decompressed and,
yeah.
and
right.
changed clothes and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm ready to hang out at home yeah. for the rest of the
day. Dress down.
Like, okay. So I go, okay, cool. I got to, I guess, put on some. And I'm like, you know what? Wait a minute. I'm going to try this thing. So it's sitting there. When I grabbed it, shoved mm-hmm. it in, dropped it, got to the grocery store, did the stuff, come back, sitting down in the house. Doing a couple things. I'm sitting back down and everything. And all of a sudden, I'm like, wait a minute, what was that? And I reach back, and there it is.
You forget about it.
Yeah.
You really do. It gets that comfortable.
Yeah.
Yep.
It's so
simple.
He's
simple
smiling
works.
It's
yeah.
like it's
simple
a,
works.
It really kind of works like that.
It is.
It's a thing you look at it, you know, and you go.
Well, you laugh.
That's
first.
Not going to work.
Right.
Mm-hmm. You know, this isn't going to work.
Yeah.
But it really, really does. What kind of. Do you do anything where you say, hey, you know, try it out for so many days or things like that? Or do you have any people that are like, well, no, I, you know.
Well, we do have a return policy.
Okay.
But what we try to like to do is we're so fortunate. We're getting more and more dealers around the country every day. And part of our point of sale is we send them a sticky holster with a demo gun, with a blue gun.
Right.
And instead of a shopkeeper or a retailer trying to explain what a sticky is, this way they just hand it to the customer. They try it themselves. So they get to try it right there at the store and find out whether it's for them or not.
Yeah. So it might not be your everyday carry holster.
It could be. Or if it fills a niche.
Yeah.
Whatever allows a customer to be able to wear as consistently as possible, and regardless of how many systems that takes,
right.
we've done our job.
Well, I can tell you right off the bat, my wife was already excited about the fact that this kind of thing exists.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Because of the fact that, you know, she's normally either a purse or something like that.
Yep.
You get a baby, you start doing that, and then it's in the purse. Then you're worried about
safety.
Does a baby get into the purse?
Absolutely.
And, you know, we've had that situation where a kid got in.
Yeah.
So she's like, you know, she wants it on her, but then she's like, you know, I'm in yoga pants or I'm in this or I'm in that. And it's like, they don't work with the holsters that you've shown me.
Yeah.
This fits that niche.
And it has so many different ways of using it. So, you know, if there's are people that just don't want it in the waistband, then it's great for purse carry. You know, every purse has some type of pocket in it,
yeah.
especially if you are carrying a smaller gun, then you can always put it in the pocket. But what's also great is that our holster is great for it staying in the purse and not dinging up the actual firearm, getting it into the keys or anything like that. And what I like the most about it is that since it has so many functions, it can work in the front, it can work in the back, in the purse. Those new carriers that are very recent to concealed carry, they don't know what position they want at first. You know, it's a lot of money if you want to get just one clip holster that works just in the front and then not like it. So ours is great because you can change positions, play around with it, you know, put it in your pocket, and then over time you get really comfortable with it. So
very cool.
It's my
awesome.
Favorite.
Do you guys get to see any of the show?
We no. did.
Oh, you did? Good.
A little yeah. bit, you know, we try to get here a little bit early.
Right.
See all the other vendors, see how excited they get with new products coming in. So
yeah. Anything
nice.
Cool that struck you, favorite, or just sort of like?
This is my first show coming in here.
So you're rather overwhelmed at this point, right?
She's got a little bit. Right now.
So it's nice to see how much enthusiasm every vendor has, you know, putting up their products everywhere, structure work, you know. So yeah, it's very nice to see.
Also got to make you feel really good that this many companies exist.
In one area.
In one little small
everybody coming
market
together.
Kind of a thing.
It's amazing.
Yeah. Cool.
And usually with waiting lists of hundreds of more that want to be here. So
crazy.
It's nice.
Crazy stuff.
It's
cool.
Nice.
Hey, thank you very much.
Thanks
Mike,
so much,
time.
Rob. Thank you
very much.
Vanessa, for your time. Cool. And whoever Stephanie is. But anyway, right. I'm Birdman, and I've got a couple more people still coming, so hang out there. And we're here at the 2017 SHOT Show. Okay, Birdman here, still at the SHOT Show 2017, hanging out in the press room. Joining me now is a gentleman who has to be described as a legend, I'd say. Mr. Gary O'Neill, how are you, sir?
Good.
Hey, when
pleasure
you,
to be here.
When I say something to somebody and I see the hat and I say, thank you for your service, it's sort of, it's always meant, but with you, you've done a whole lot, haven't you?
Well, some people say that. I was just me. I believed in what the cause, you know, served country, served American people, and most of all is protect the Constitution of the United States and Bill of Rights. That was my oath, you know, foreign and domestic enemies.
Foreign, you know. Domestic enemies.
Yep.
And you took that to heart, didn't you?
Oh, yes.
Yeah. So talk to me a little bit about growing up. Where did you grow up?
I grew up in western Kansas and then Nebraska and Colorado and South Dakota, all the Midwest there.
Mm-hmm.
South Dakota, my mom, you know, she was native Ogallala Sioux. My dad was Irish. And I joined the Army at an early age. Kind of very early age, and because my ancestors on my dad's side, my fifth great grandfather, fourth great grandfather, and grand uncle was in the Frontier Rangers in the 1700s, and they fought, did the Oath of Allegiance to America, and fought in Revolutionary War in the War of 1812.
Wow.
And pretty much every war that conflict this country's been in, there's been an O'Neill. Either an uncle, cousin, or a grandfather, a father, that served for this country. So when it comes to being patriotic and it comes to be serving, I don't think I had a choice. I think it was in my DNA. And then on my mom's side, goes all the way back to Bozeman Trail and Battle of Little Bighorn, stuff like that.
Wow. Pretty
you know,
cool.
So
you're here at SHOT Show, and you're here with Nathan Love, of course, with Frontier Tactical. What are you here promoting at the show itself?
Well, a little bit about everything. You know, I got several people that I know, mostly, you know, Frontier Tactical, because the system, I believe in the system, and it's a multi-caliber weapon system on a AR platform, and talking about battlefield recovery of different rounds, stuff like that. You're out of ammo, you can pick up AK rounds, you know, 7.62x39 and use it, and you can use 9mm, you know, whatever that country has in armament, you know, we can adapt to it by changing the barrel or the bolt in 3 minutes or less.
Yeah, and I look at it as sort of like the perfect zombie apocalypse gun.
Absolutely.
Because if you look at The Walking Dead, I'm always like going, where are they finding this ammo all in the same range? And they never seem to find it.
Right.
But here.
Yeah, you got over 90 choices. You just
90 choices. Just, okay, well, switch out to this barrel, this bolt carrier group, and things like that.
Yeah.
But you've got a speaking series. Isn't that correct?
Yeah, I'm doing a speaking tours and stuff. I'm just starting it this year. I've been doing it off and on. I spoke for Donald Trump. I was a keynote speaker a couple times for him. Congressman, representing different nonprofit organizations that works directly with our veterans and also our first responders, you know. And I work that. And also I'm a DPS contractor for the state of Texas and a consultant for Bragg, Special Operations.
Very good. You know. You have a website where people can get a hold of you to find out.
Yeah, we're putting it together. Like I'm not, you know, I'm old school, you know. Heck with the telephone. I'm still working on smoke signal. You know, it's simpler.
It's getting set up. It'll be up and running soon. We're working with him on it.
Very cool. So, Nate, how has it been working with this gentleman here?
Surreal.
Yeah.
I mean, this is Gary O'Neill's one of my personal, you know, probably the number one guy on my personal hero list. Role model, mentor. You know, some people have other role models and mentors, but this is the guy that I strive to be like. True American, skilled in his craft, warrior through and through, really a master at everything he puts his mind to, except drinking. He can't out-drink me.
Oh, wow. Okay.
No, okay. Hey, what do you expect, man? You know, I'm half Irish and half Indian and... You know, half me goes drinks, and the other half goes on a warpath.
Wow.
But you know what my problem is?
That's one angry man.
I'm a bartender, so, you know.
His own bartender.
And Nathan, you launched just recently the mentorship podcast.
Correct.
And is Gary probably?
Yeah, Gary actually inspired me to do that based on the advice and, well, it was not really advice as much as a command. An order given to him by the late Bob Howard. It's not his right to keep his knowledge, skills, and experience to himself, that he needs to get out and train and share that information. And that's what caused me to go and start the podcast on mentorship.
Yeah, it's Bob was, he was my hero. He was my mentor. And most of all, he was my friend.
Yeah.
And we did a lot of stuff together, served in a lot of different organizations. And I found out that he was in the hospital with pancreatic cancer. So I called the floor nurse up and I said, well, this is Chief O'Neill at Fort Bragg. Tell Colonel Howard that we're sending a lot of prayers out for him for a speedy recovery because we got a 12-mile ruck march in 3 days.
Wow.
And I get a phone call from his son, says, stand by the phone, my dad wants to talk to you. And I go, well, I thought I pissed him off. You know, that's one guy you didn't want to get on the bad side. And so I stood by, and he called me up, and he told me, he says, young Ranger, don't say a word. I made my amends with my maker, I'm in no pain, and it's my time.
Wow.
But you, on the other hand, have been trained by some of the best combatants this country's ever produced, and you took it to a higher level. You don't have the right to take it to the grave with you. Get out there, train the troops, and Charlie Mike, continue the mission.
Mm-hmm.
And he says, get your story out and all that. And I go, but sir, he goes, what did I say? I'm on transmit, you're on receive, Charlie Mike, get out there and get your story out there and start teaching these young guys and Charlie Mike. He hung up the phone, and a few days later, he was gone.
Wow.
So I had a command order from the fellow officer, special ops guy, great American hero.
Most decorated soldier.
Yeah, the most decorated soldier in history of this country. And... to give me a direct order on his deathbed. So I really don't have a choice. So he's the one that, him and my platoon leader, Gary Dolan, were the ones, him, Jacob Venko, they're all three of them, were in the Hall of Fame, Ranger Hall of Fame. And they nominated me to go in front of the board for the Hall of Fame. And they vent everything, man. I mean, it's right down to the wire.
Right.
And so I got inducted in the Ranger Hall of Fame, and I've been in the limelight ever since. I really don't like to be out there in front. I like being behind the lines, you know, and sneaking around. Nobody know who you are, but, you know, as a responsible American adult, what are we doing for the next generation? And if we're not working on the solution to the problem, we're part of the problem. And ain't no way in hell that I'm going to be a part of a problem in American society. I can't do it. It's against the Constitution. It's against my my judgment of my rights, you know, of being an American. You know, and I've served in some of the toughest units that this country's got. From Rangers to Special Forces, you know, to anti-terrorists, everything. Parachuting, you know, with the Golden Knights, Halo Committee, teaching combat tactics, setting up oxygen systems, experimenting with weapons and making sure that we're getting the best stuff, right. You know. And nobody wants to go to war with the equipment that's made by the lowest bidder.
Right.
It don't put too much confidence in what your abilities are, you know.
So talking about equipment then, have you been able to look around the show much?
No, not really, because I've been working with different, you know, foundations and stuff, and speaking and interviews and stuff. So hopefully tomorrow I'll be able to walk around and have and see guys I haven't seen in a long time.
Right.
You know, this is like a reunion. And all the guys that's retired now building weapons or knives or stuff and equipment for the soldiers, because they've been there.
Right.
And they know shoddy equipment, and they want to make sure that, you know, if they go into combat, they got good equipment.
Right.
So
meanwhile, somebody's doing crazy stuff off range.
Yeah.
Awesome. Cool. Anything else that you want to get out there?
I tell you, it's working with these nonprofits, you know, Special Operations Charity Network is one of them. I have a nonprofit. It basically works with, you know, law enforcement and first responders and stuff. Kids are our future. We got to take care of kids. We're losing generations of kids because of social media and in the schools. You know,
right?
You know, it's just it's atrocious. You know what these kids think that's right, but it's not.
Yeah.
You know, we need to get America back to the old pioneer spirit. You know, if you look at some of these movies that's come out, for instance, 13 Hours. Got good friends of mine that was there. Mm-hmm. I've worked with them. Soldiers with them. Oz, man. We served together in 7th Group and stuff. And Tig, he was in the Marines. You know, and they fought. And then you get the Lone Survivor. You know, it was a mission that was kind of boshed, you know, the situation and stuff like that. But the one thing it shows is American fighting spirit.
Yeah.
We're the greatest country in the world. And we are the greatest fighters in the world. And I'll fight any SOB. Almost messed up there.
Uh-oh, that's okay.
Yeah. I caught myself.
We can get away with certain stuff.
But, you know, we are. And I've been in pretty much every country in the world. I've shed blood on 7 continents. And, you know, it's time for us to get back where we're supposed to be, get our family values back, get the political realm under control, you know, and get our budget back where it's supposed to be.
Right.
You know, and tighten our belts up, get the industry back in. That's why I like Trump. You know, he might not be, you know, know everything, you know, but one thing about Trump does, he knows how to pick the right people to make the right negotiations to do the right job. And he doesn't have a hesitation whatsoever. If you ain't doing your job, he'll fire you.
So you think it's a good choice for Secretary of Defense?
Oh, you know, we needed him. We needed him from the beginning.
Yeah.
Okay. And the administration, you know, the Democrat, this progressive liberalism.
Yeah.
I tell you what, man, if you're a Democrat, get out of America. Your policies don't belong here.
They're cancer.
You know, it's cancer. It's a it's like a big boil on your butt, man. It just festers up, you know. You can't sit down, you can't move, and all it does is just rake in pus.
Right.
And that's all these politicians are, man. They rake in pus and infecting everybody, you know.
Cool. Nate, final words here.
I would say that, if I only had one weapon to take into combat, I would probably take Gary's resume.
Yeah, nice.
You could kill just about anything on this planet with that.
Good.
And he's got a book, American Warrior. You can find it on Amazon. He does autographing when he's around. He's real approachable. He's got the speaking tour going on now, and you know, at some point the movie will be coming out. So
very good. Cool.
Yeah. It's all about. I'd like to see the old pioneer spirit come back in modern times and have that mental mindset of who we are, you know, and the pride that we have being Americans. You know, let's stop being complacent, lazy, and in a box, you know.
Yep.
You know, let's stop it. Get off your butt, man. And we got the momentum going, and the American people has to continue with that momentum and stay on the phones and keep the politicians straight. Let's quit being lazy and letting them do the job. They work for us, the American people. We don't work for them.
Yeah.
You know, and quit stealing out of our pockets, you know.
Thank you, sir.
Thanks for having us, Rob.
Hey, thank you for your time today. Appreciate that. I've got one more guest over here we're going to talk to, so hang on out, and we'll be right back in just a sec.
Right.
Okay, here we are, still hanging out at the press room. I don't know why they tell you to wait for a second, because it's, like, immediate. But and also, I've got two more guests. I've got, first of all, this guy. He's my favorite artist right now. This is when I say artist, I mean person that creates art.
Yeah, I don't label myself an artist. I execute stuff.
Yeah, execute stuff. Well, you execute it well. It's Russ Bacon from Nevada Cerakote.
Hello.
How are you doing?
I'm pooped.
You're pooped?
I'm very tired. It's been a long, a handful of days.
It gets to be tiring. So.
Well, I came in here on an empty tank. I mean, I was working literally right up to the moment that everybody said, get in the truck, we got to go.
Right.
So, yeah, last-minute stuff for people. And, you know, you give them months in advance and say, let me know what you need. But, you know, you always get last-minute stuff. So.
Always the last minute. They go, hey, well, by the way, oh, can you do this, this, and that? And by the way, that one thing, yeah, just do that twice.
Right.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, and that we did a couple of those things twice.
Yeah, cool. So of the stuff that you created for this show, favorites? Yeah. Put them on a spot.
Oh, man.
It's got to be the bubble. The bubble thing.
The bubble fighter's pretty cool.
Fighter. Yeah.
Although the one that seems to have gotten the most traction is our Boston Bruins rifle with the Boston Strong and the bear on the stock and stuff. We had an executive from a large distributor come by the booth and ask if they could have it.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. But they can't have that one in particular. We're going to do another one for them.
Going to do another one for
them. It's going to end up in a shadow box above his desk at his office. So,
very cool.
Kind of cool.
Very cool. So you, of course, are the guy that created the VFOB rifle that I have, which is a SIG MPX. It has the Ohio flag on one side, the Birdman logo on the back.
Right.
I should call it the Birdman gun because that's the biggest part of it.
Yeah, I think so. That stencil for your stock was tremendously challenging, but it looks really cool. I show everybody that, so with the fade and everything. So
yeah, and then of course you created the Birdman Edition G19.
Yeah,
so
with the copper
with the copper, and I've got copper end plate from Classy. Was it Classy Raptor? Yeah, Classy Raptor.
Yeah,
that's starting to patina, and it's matching the gun
blended
exactly.
Right in.
So
you know, as a result of you putting that on that pistol. He now follows me and likes my stuff.
Yeah?
I follow him and stuff like that.
Well, that's how it works, the whole social interaction, and we find out about other companies, and companies come together and sort of help each other and support each other and all that kind of thing.
10-4.
Which is a good thing to do. So let's talk about the show. You've been walking around quite a bit.
Yeah.
You versus some of the others have actually gotten to see some of the show. What are you seeing that's cool this year?
You know, it...
We'd called it, just so you know, we'd called it on the Get on Target show that it was going to be the year of accessories and not so much because, like, last year was like AR-15 Central.
Right.
And this year seems, I think it's more of accessories.
Well, I definitely see that there's a change in a little bit of a shift in what I would perceive to be the marketplace. You know, with our new administration coming into office, and there's a little bit of pressure off of purchasers, consumers, to go out and buy what I call need guns.
Mm-hmm.
And they're going to now start to focus more on want guns or want accessories. So I think people are going to start to be a little bit more choosy with what they purchase. And so guys like us that can, you know, they're not going to be selling the DPMS, you know, entry-level rifle off the shelf like you would if we had Hillary Clinton in office.
Mm-hmm.
So people are going to start to be picking and choosing their stuff, and they're going to maybe spend a little bit more money, but they're really going to think about their purchase. So I would say, yeah, you know, anything different, accessories, you know, something to make your rifle or your pistol better or your shooting experience better. So I think there's going to be a lot of opportunity for companies that aren't as well known, you know, not the regular, you know, big boys
right
around the block, and I think that's going to work out for guys like me.
Very cool. Yeah. Now, you are known as, your company is Nevada Cerakote. Mm-hmm. Coatings, though, have come quite a way
yep
since the beginning of it all. Now, Cerakote's here showing off a new coating.
Their Elite Series.
Yeah.
Which I had a conversation with them the other day about the advantages of that product. And it only comes in six colors, but the six colors that it comes in constitutes roughly 80% of the color palette that we normally use. Ooh. So grays and tans and green and blacks. So there's six of them all together. They're all kind of subdued, and the advantage to that product is that it is entirely manufactured of ceramic material. There's no dye, there's no additives, there's nothing to add flake to it, so inherently it's thinner, so you have you can use it in tighter tolerance areas where normally you'd have a, you know, an issue with that, and it's also a lot more durable. So this will be a product that you'll see a lot of manufacturers have for like really durable factory finish on products.
Yeah, so you think you'll still be able to do, like, the battle rash stuff with it?
Yeah, we're going to have to play with it just like we did initially
right
with the original stuff. I mean, they had no idea what we were going to do with the original stuff, and the marketplace kind of just, people started to develop techniques to apply the material. This is going to be the same way. And I asked them, I'm like, oh, have you guys done any, you know, masking and doing overlays with different colors? And they're like, well, we haven't really done that yet. So somebody's going to have to figure out how to do that. So
right. Cool.
Challenge accepted.
Big question. Copper? Maybe not.
They've got a couple that I think if I could blend colors together, we might be able to get the same type of thing. Problem is they don't have any bright colors. So like, you know, you can't, it's they're all subdued, and because it is strictly just a ceramic, they're limited to that color palette.
Yeah.
So
this is probably a little more toward the durability side of things.
Durability.
With some colorization.
Yeah. I mean, you know, they're beautiful colors, but the palette's limited. And I don't think they have any plans on coming out with or attempting to come out with any other colors. Of course, they could be keeping that in their back pocket.
Yeah.
They want to sell the heck out of the product, get it on the marketplace, get everybody using it, and then they'll...
Those darn manufacturers.
I'm telling you, man.
They sometimes are smart. You're
killing me.
Yeah. Okay. So anything else happening that you want to talk about or talk about this show?
This show has been pretty cool. We've been stopped a few times by people, which is kind of a nice feeling, you know, like, hey, you're those guys. You know, it's kind of cool that people pick you out of the crowd. Proof Research did the same thing because they've seen some of our work with some of the barrels that they have in some guns. And cultivating established relationships, cultivating relationships that haven't really fully budded yet. But it's been a good show. A couple of good new opportunities and nothing earth-shattering, but all moving in the right direction anyway. Might be getting another laser.
No.
There's another laser that I want to get. So.
There's a laser in your future, huh?
A second one, yes.
A laser. Yeah.
Freaking laser beams.
But are you going to get an ill-tempered bass or no?
Yeah, so this is always a good event to go to, but I tell you what, I'm looking more forward to NRA again this year. So
yeah, NRA of course is in Atlanta.
Hotlanta.
So we'll be having fun in Hotlanta.
Yeah, absolutely. Hopefully it's before it gets really hot.
Yeah, no, April's not too bad, but usually a lot of rain.
Yeah,
so you know,
that's all right. I don't mind that.
You know, the funny thing is most people don't know that Atlanta gets more rain than Portland, Oregon.
No, I'm not. I'm from the East Coast originally, so I've had my fair share of rain that way. So,
hey, so Russ Bacon, thank you very much.
Thanks, Rob.
You'll be seeing more Birdman editions by this man for certain, for sure.
10-4.
Cool.
Right on, man.
Probably something really cool as well.
Yeah, there's going to be some. This is going to be a good year.
Awesome.
2017 is going to be good.
Hey, so I've got one more person, and that'll be it for the update today here at SHOT Show. I'm Birdman, so hang on just a second. I'll get her up here, and we'll go right at it. Okay, as promised, I've got a lady with me, and we're going to talk about some cool things that are going on here. It's Sarah. How you doing?
I'm good.
From SSP Eyewear. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so how has the show been for you so far?
Well, it's my first show. It's my first SHOT Show, not my first show.
Okay.
But it has been very interesting, very busy, very fast-paced, a lot of people coming through.
Yeah, it's high foot traffic here.
It is, and, you know, they told me that, but I don't think I really actually fully prepared myself for that. So
you said you've done a lot of shows. What shows have you done?
It's my first year with SSP Eyewear, so a lot of my shows have consisted of safety conferences, and you know, not only do we specialize in tactical, but the industrial as well. So safety conferences, and we've done. We work a lot with law enforcement and a lot of law enforcement events and different things like that.
Okay.
But I've never done a show at this capacity with SSP Eyewear. So.
Okay. Yeah, and I've done shows with more capacity than this. But not like this show, because this show is I call it the 10x10 central show. It's like everything's 10x10.
Mm-hmm.
Boom, 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 boom. And there's more 10x10s here than I've ever seen anywhere at any show.
Mm-hmm.
And then you get like 60,000 to 80,000 people, and it's just an insane amount of communication constantly, isn't it?
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
So what any new products that you guys are showing off here? Or
we are. We recently introduced our top focal kits, which are geared towards the... those who are having trouble focusing in on their front sights.
Mm-hmm.
So there comes a certain point in your life where you need bifocals.
Stop
to
it. Don't pick on me.
You need bifocals to read and, you know, have those things that are up close come into more, have more clarity. So one of the biggest requests that we got was a bifocal, but with the bifocal at the top of the lens.
Right.
And so that's what we did. We put the bifocal at the top of the lens so that when you are shooting, you have the ability to keep your head down in shooting position,
yeah.
Look through the top of your glasses at your front sight, and focus it in and line up your shot. But what we did was we took it a step further and we made these interchangeable kits so that you have the ability to take out the lens,
right,
and change out the lens with maybe a plane lens, or I have some instructors will do a bottom bifocal. And what that allows you to do is to, again, focus in on your front sight, but then you can use your non-dominant side and focus down on your target without the interference of the magnification.
Crazy.
And so you have the ability to line up your shot completely without moving your head at all. People that wear bifocals will understand that they're constantly changing out glasses.
Yeah.
They're constantly moving their head, tilting it different ways. This kind of eliminates some of that movement.
Yeah, we've used these at the range I do with the get on target at the hub. Bruce actually bought a pair before he even knew that I met your company. And I came back from actually Montana where I met you guys. And he's like, oh, you got to see these. And I'm like, that's just funny because I just met the owner. And he proceeded to tell me how cool they were, how well they worked, all of that. And without any sales pitch, he got them off of a website and did it that way. So, and they of course have done another thing that you do is you can make custom lenses.
We do. We make custom glasses. So these kind of gear a lot towards the people that own gun ranges. Mm-hmm. You know, new shooters that are coming in for lessons and getting educated. You know, they don't realize they don't have iPro.
Right.
And so these are a really good outlet for gun ranges or, you know, even other companies for marketing tactics to come through, have eyewear for their clients. But what we can do is we can put logos on the side temples. And
if
we have different...
From, yeah, I'm going to show, yeah.
So we do have different
right there,
varieties.
You can see that the logo is right there on it. Good.
And on the other side as well, mm-hmm. Yes. And so again, you know, their clients can either give them back, or if they happen to walk off with them, you know, they have something with their range. And,
right.
You know, it is. It's a very inexpensive way to be efficient and provide, you know, their clients with the eyewear protection, but also, you know, get their name out there.
Have that branding going on. Mm-hmm. Awesome. Cool. Anything else you want to mention about the fun you've been having here in Las Vegas?
It is definitely a lot of fun in Las Vegas, and I think in all honesty, it's you can only have so much fun for so many days until.
And then you're ready to go
home. Until
you're counting
down the hours for that plane ride home.
Very cool. Yeah. So you're about there, yeah. Well, Friday somewhere around 10 a.m. is when you're gonna be like, okay, done.
Yeah.
You might be right there right now. I don't know. Just guessing.
Almost. I think I'll make it till the last day, but
very cool.
We'll see how it goes.
Awesome. Sarah, thank you very much for your time.
Thank
SSP
you.
Eyewear. You check out all the links. Hey, I'm Birdman, and that's it for today's update at the 2017 SHOT Show here in Las Vegas, Nevada. This is Birdman Media Patriot Edition, and I'll see you soon.